portion of this video is brought to you by HelloFresh. I've been living with solar panels for almost 5 years now here in Massachusetts, and I thought it was a time to take a look back at how it's been going. There's been some twists and turns with solar production and how it's fared going through the cold and snow. I also added a Tesla Powerwall into the mix a couple of years ago. There are definitely some things I wish I knew before getting solar panels and a battery installed. So how's it performed? And do I still think it's a good idea to get solar panels on my home? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. If you haven't seen my previous videos on my solar panel installation, I'll include links in the description so you can check them out. But for this one, I'm going to focus on a few things. The basics of what I have installed in my current home and why, the costs, the production and how it's been going, what adding a battery meant for the overall performance, and what I wish I had known before getting into this. I think everyone's had that, oh man, I wish I had known that before I did this feeling from time to time. I get it a lot. But to get right into it, my wife and I had solar panels installed in the fall of 2018. So we're not quite at the 5-year mark yet, but there's a reason why I'm doing this video now instead of waiting. We're building a highly energy efficient house right now that's going to have some solar and home batteries as part of the mix. And if you're interested, I'll include links to videos about that in the description. But I've been doing a lot of research and evaluating of our current system versus what we're planning to get. So this stuff is very much in the front of my mind right now. The second reason is that there's a lot of shifting solar panel incentives around the country, and with the spring not too far away, I know a lot of people may be looking for some guidance and reviews. And on that note, I've got a big announcement that I'm really excited to share with all of you, so stay tuned. Anyway, on the current house, I have a 9.49 kilowatt solar panel array that's made up of 26 LG solar panels with N-phase microinverters. Unfortunately, LG has exited the solar panel game, so you can't get these panels anymore, which is a shame because they're really good. Now, my house is surrounded by trees on the western side. Our roof also doesn't face the ideal direction, which would be having a southern-facing roof. In our case, our roof is basically split east and west, so we chose to have solar panels placed on both sides. That way, we're able to capture more sunlight over the course of the day versus mainly in the morning or mainly in the afternoon. Between the less than optimal orientation and mid to late afternoon shade from our trees, our house is definitely not an ideal setup, but it doesn't mean that solar isn't a good path. I'll get into why in just a little bit. But before getting into the cost and performance, there's something else that's been a little less than optimal for me, and that's my diet, which is where today's sponsor HelloFresh comes in. I have a crazy schedule and never seem to have time to plan for a good quality home-cooked meal. So I take some shortcuts and eat some not so great frozen meals or takeout. HelloFresh makes meal prep so easy because I can skip the planning and trip to the store. That means more time for doing things like making these videos and spending time with my family. My favorite part though is that all of the ingredients are pre-portioned and easy to just set up, follow the recipe card, and end up with a delicious meal without any waste. In fact, the ingredients are always super fresh because they come straight from the farm to your door in less than 7 days. There's meal choices for every kind of diet too. From calorie smart to carb smart to veggie or family friendly. Now, I still eat meat from time to time, but I'm mostly in the veggie camp now. There's something for everyone. Go to HelloFresh.com and use the code MattFerrell65 for 65% off plus free shipping. That's HelloFresh.com and the code MattFerrell65. Thanks to HelloFresh and all of you for supporting the channel. Now, as for the cost of my solar panel system, back in 2018, when we had just the solar panels installed, no Tesla Powerwall yet, it cost $29,609. That's before incentives. Now that's about $3.22 per watt. At that time, we had the 30% federal solar tax credit available, which means being able to get $8,883 off of our 2018 tax burden. Now this kind of incentive isn't being pulled from a pool of taxpayer money. It's pretty much the same thing as a child tax credit that families can claim on their taxes. It reduces your tax burden for that year, which probably means that you overpaid your taxes from auto withholdings from your paycheck. That could mean a refund, but it all depends on how much you had withheld and how much you owe. You might see the full 30% in a check or only a portion of it. It's kind of confusing, but in our case, we did end up seeing the full amount and sent that directly to the solar panel loan that we took out. That knocked our out-of-pocket costs down to $20,726. Now, on top of that, we got into the Solar Renewable Energy Credit System, or SREC, here in Massachusetts right before it changed to the new program called SMART. We get a check for $126.22 a month for SREC payouts, which expires after 10 years. I won't go into all the details of SREC. I've got other videos that deal with that linked below, but the newer programs you'll often see don't pay out as much. Even though they pay out less, the newer programs like Smart pay out in a more measured way that helps to avoid double dipping. Now, I guess you could say it's trying to live up to its name. Now, in any case, we've received about $6,563 of our SREC payments so far, which means that our out-of-pocket cost drops down to $14,163. But that leads into how production has fared. If you saw my 4 years with solar video last year, you'll know that 2021 was an oddball year. Our solar production was down by about 11.4% from the year before and 3% from 2019. 2021 was the worst year to date. It just barely missed the baseline production number our solar installer had predicted for that year, which was 6,479 kilowatt hours versus 6,549 kilowatt hours, which was about 1% off. But the mystery as to why came down to an unusually wet summer here in Massachusetts in 2021. It was the third warmest summer and third wettest on record. So it was very cloudy and overcast, which knocked summer production lower than the previous years. So how did things look in 2022? Well, it was the best year we've ever had. By the numbers, looking only at full calendar years, 2019 had 6.7 megawatt hours of production, 2020 had 7.2 megawatt hours, 2021 had 6.5 megawatt hours, and 2022 had 7.4 megawatt hours. Looking at month by month, you can see how much better July through October was versus that same period in 2021. But those numbers are kind of meaningless without some context. How much energy did we use, and how much did it save us in our electricity costs so far? Well, where I live, we get one-to-one net metering credit off our electric bill. If we use 100 kilowatt hours from the grid, but we export 70 kilowatt hours of excess solar production into the grid, we only have to pay for 30 kilowatt hours. Now, this scenario is definitely not the norm across the US. Some areas only credit back wholesale electricity costs, and other areas don't credit anything back at all. In my case, it's a pretty nice setup and arrangement with the utility, but if you're considering this for yourself, you'll need to look into how net metering works in your area. EnergySage has great details on every state in the US, and I'll link that in the description too. Now, we've been saving somewhere around $1,500 a year in electricity costs, but we've seen that tick up significantly just in the past year or two. On average, US electricity prices have risen about 14% or about 2 cents per kilowatt hour per year over a 10-year span between 2010 and 2020. But this past year or two has been absolutely dramatic. In 2020, we were paying an average of about 22 cents per kilowatt hour. In 2021, it was 24 cents, and in 2022, it was 30 cents. And now in 2023, it's at 37 cents per kilowatt hour. That's about a 40% increase between 2020 and 2023. The end result is that my solar panels are saving me more money per year than we originally estimated based on that average increase of 2 cents per kilowatt hour per year. Just as an example to show you how dramatic it can be, if you took the total amount my house used, grid or solar, from 2022, it was 12.6 megawatt hours. We average around 1 megawatt hour a month. And yes, I know that sounds like a lot. I live in the US and our homes use a lot of electricity. At 22 cents per kilowatt hour, that would cost us about $230 a month. With a rate of 37 cents, where we are right now, it would average us a bill of $390 a month. So to put that into real savings that we saw, 2021 fell a little below our normal of $1,500 in savings because of the lower production, but we still saw about $1,416 in savings. For 2022, with an average of 30 cents per kilowatt hour, we saved about $2,285. At this point, almost 5 years in, we've saved just shy of $7,000 off our electric bill. So if you knock that cost off our out-of-pocket costs, we're down to $7,163 left. Between the SREC payments of around $1,500 a year and electric bill savings that could be as high as $2,800 for the current rates, our solar panel setup will work itself off in less than 2 more years. That's 1 year faster than we were anticipating. But what about the battery? We did add a Tesla Powerwall that I earned through the Tesla referral program a couple of years ago, so the only out-of-pocket expense I had was the installation costs. And because of that, I'm not gonna break down what the true cost of savings would have been, but I am participating in a virtual power plant or VPP in my area. That's when your home batteries can be used by the local utility for peak shaving during times of high demand on the grid. It's exactly what the name implies, a massive distributed battery system. For me, that means during the summer months, my battery can be used between 30 and 60 times during small windows in the evening. Now, energy use spikes when everyone gets home from work, cranks up the AC, and cooks dinner. The benefit is that I get paid for my utility's use of my battery. I've got a full video that breaks this down, which I'll link to in the description as well. There's gonna be a lot of links in the description for this one. But last year, I got a check for $772, and this year, I got a check for $736. For me, this program will only last 5 years, so if this keeps up, it should total somewhere just below $4,000. That can do a pretty good job offsetting the cost of a home battery. Now, if we also had time of use rates, we could use the battery to save even more money that way too. A VPP plus time of use rates could equal a pretty big savings that could really blunt the total cost of a battery like the Powerwall. Now, you might be looking at $12,000 to $15,000 or so to install one Powerwall in my area. So obviously for me, if I had paid full price for the Powerwall, the VPP program by itself would not cover the full battery, but it does help. A battery is also more like a backup generator, which helps with quality of life. So the return on investment has a very different calculation depending on what your goals are. It comes in handy when there's a power outage in the winter because of a downed tree limb that might take out power for half the day. So what is it that I wish I had known before I got into this? Well, there's two things that jump right out at me from my experience. First is the importance of hiring the right people to install solar panels and battery. I used Energysage to find my solar installer and had a fantastic experience. It was so good that I'm sticking with the same installer for my new house. However, when it came to the installer for my Tesla Powerwall, it was a completely different experience. The waitlist for Tesla to install my Powerwall was a very long time, so I opted to go with a third party to do the installation. Tesla recommended an installer, which is who I went with. I mean, Tesla was recommending them after all. So I put my trust in that. Bit of a mistake. To say the experience was bad would be an absolute understatement. The quality of the work was highly questionable, and when I mentioned that I was going to be talking about this negative experience in a video, that company threatened to sue me. Now, after that happened, I did some digging into them and found a trail of questionable work and tactics, so I really wish I hadn't taken the recommendation at face value. It's my fault. Now, thankfully, all of the issues I had have been resolved by a totally different company, so it's all good. Now, the second thing I wish I had known beforehand was how solar panels behave with snow and rain. Now, I'm not talking about snow covering the panels and blocking energy production, but what happens with the snow. Solar panels are a bit like having a metal roof. It's a slick surface that water and snow will slide right off very quickly. In the case of snow, you can end up with a terrifying snow avalanche sliding off your roof all at once. You're talking about tons of snow falling 10, 20, or 30 feet, depending on how high your roof is. The reason that happens is that the snow that makes contact with a glass surface starts to melt relatively quickly. As soon as a fine layer of water builds up between the panel and the snowpack, it's like greasing the skids and it all comes down really fast. You can also have issues with rain. If your panels are installed near the edge of a roof, you have to remember that the sheets of rain that flow towards your gutter are picking up more speed on the glass surface versus an asphalt shingle, as well as the fact that the water's raised up an additional 3 to 5 inches from the roof surface. And depending on how close the panels are to the edge of the roof, the water may just shoot out over the gutter. Not the end of the world, but something to consider. In my case, that wasn't a big problem, but the snow issue was concerning. I got a roof rig with a long extension pole, and anytime there's more than 4 inches of snow in the roof, I'll go out there and do a controlled removal. Now, the last thing I want is someone coming out the back door or the garage and getting hit with an avalanche of snow. Overall, I don't think it's a showstopper by any stretch, but if I had known ahead of time, I may have talked to my installer about adding snow guards in certain locations to prevent the avalanche. Now, as I mentioned, I'm going to be moving in a few months, which means that I'll be selling my house. It's shown that solar panels can increase the resale value of your home because it produces its own electricity. In my area here in Massachusetts, solar panels are very popular, so I expect that to play out in my case. But I am looking forward to sharing how it actually plays out, see if my hunch is correct. That brings me to the big announcement that I mentioned in the beginning, and this one actually makes me a little nervous because I've never done anything like this before, but a lot of you have reached out to me for help and guidance on getting solar panels for your home, asking me to review quotes, give feedback, tips, questions that you should be asking installers. And that's exactly why I created the Achieve Energy Security with Solar Guide. It can be overwhelming because you don't know what you don't know. I've been there. And I want you to feel confident about what you actually need for your home and personal goals. After going through this guide, you'll be able to figure out how much solar energy you need, what kind of equipment might make sense for your house, and how to vet a qualified solar installer. This will even help you decide if solar is actually the right move for you or not. I'm launching this guide today, which is still in beta, at a discounted price for a limited time. Go to the URL in the description for more details and to become a founding member. As part of this initial offer, I'm going to be holding a group Zoom call to answer questions that you might have after going through the guide. I'm really excited to help as many of you as I can to go through the process and to evolve this guide over time. So at the end of the day, am I happy with going solar? It's a big yes. It's achieved all the goals my wife and I had hoped for. No, it didn't cover 100% of our electricity use, but that was never our goal. We wanted to reduce our electric bill, take some control over how our electricity was generated, and have a system that could carry us through a blackout, all in a financially responsible way. Now, all the boxes were ticked for us. So what do you think? Do you want solar for your house? If you have solar, what are the things you wish you had known beforehand? Jump in the comments and share it with everybody. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, where we'll be discussing some of your feedback. Thanks to all of my patrons who get ad-free versions of every video, and welcome to new Supporter Plus members, Jay and Betty Crater, Steve Hall, and Gary Reardon. Your support really helps to produce these videos. And thanks to all of you for watching and commenting. I'll see you in the next one.